Good morning.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court. Stacey Newman on behalf of Appellant Kentrell Welch. I'd like to reserve 3 minutes on rebuttal, and I can keep an eye on my time. The issue in this case is whether the Federal District Court erred in granting summary judgment against Mr. Welch, holding that he failed to satisfy the Prison Litigation Reform Act's exhaustion requirement. Because the record supports inferences in Mr. Welch's favor that the Nevada grievance system is opaque to the point of being unknowable and to the point where even its own NDOC, Nevada Department of Corrections officials, disagree about how the system is to work, this court should reverse.
How many grievances prior to this one did your client file?
Your Honor, in the record, we have a span from about 2016 to 2022, and that reflects about, I believe, 163 grievances.
And he won 5 of them?
I believe it was 8 were either partially granted or fully granted.
And he negotiated his way through those?
He was able to progress to the end. I would note that in one of those, he did proceed at the informal level 4 times, and that was granted. So various ways of navigating the system, but yes.
He's a pretty good jailhouse lawyer, isn't he?
Well, Your Honor, Mr. Welch was only able to prevail on a very, very small percentage.
Prevailing is not really the issue, is it? The question is whether his rights are so opaque he can't possibly understand them. And yet this is a gentleman who, by my count here, filed 189 grievances from 2014 to 2021. He won 5 outright, 3 were partially. In a jailhouse situation, that's not bad. He knows the system. He knows how to work the system. And now he's saying, hey, I didn't get to really exhaust it because I don't understand the system. That doesn't make any sense, does it?
Well, Your Honor, in looking at the test set out in Ross v. Blake, it does not require that an inmate show that he's never successful in the grievance system or that any inmate can't make it through occasionally.
What is it, a percentage rule?
No, Your Honor, the rule as articulated in Ross v. Blake is whether, and I'll quote, no reasonable inmate can make sense of what it demands.
And here, and you don't think with all this litigation that he's been involved in and the success that he's had that he can't make any sense of it?
That is what we're arguing, and we think this is really reflected when you look at what happened at Mr. Welch's first attempt to grieve retaliation.
You mean the one where he wrote on it specifically, and I'm looking, maybe I've got the wrong one here, ER 580, information attached for tracking purposes. Is that what you're talking about?
Yes, that
where that language is pulled right from the, what you claim are the, is the opaque system, and means it's informal to the warden, right?
Yes, Your Honor. I am referring to that grievance.
And then the second one, he chose to file suit before it was resolved, right?
Yes, Your Honor. In that case, he filed the grievance, and he did file suit the next day. However, this court's precedent makes clear in Sadozi v. Davis, which the district court did cite to, that the only relevant date for exhaustion purposes is the amended complaint, which was in March of the following year. But I'm getting back to that first retaliation grievance Your Honor referred. That was rejected for not starting at the informal level. However, it's not clear on the face of the grievance procedure, which is Administrative Regulation 740, that that was not allowed. And at the Rule 30b-6 deposition, where the NDOC designee testified, he specifically said that an inmate can start grieving
at
the first level.
Maybe I'm looking at the wrong part of the policy. I'm looking at ER 559. And it says the inmate shall file an informal grievance form that states for tracking purposes when an issue goes directly to the warden first level for a decision such as disciplinary appeals, visiting denials, any allegation of sexual abuse or male censorship, and whether it's right or wrong for this complaint, he chose to use that language that came right from the policies, right?
Yes, Your Honor, and despite doing that, he was still rejected. And as I was saying, at the 30B6 deposition, the NDOC designee, whose testimony is binding upon the organization, said in 3 different places that an inmate can start grieving at the first level, that the informal level is not necessary.
But you seem to be arguing, counsel, that it isn't the fact that he's sophisticated, it's how successful he's been. If he hasn't been successful in his previous grievances, then we have to say there's no exhaustion requirement under the Prison Litigation Reform Act. Is that your position?
We believe that is one factor among many on the record that we developed showing.
What else?
So, like I was saying, the testimony of the designee, where he is at odds with this other prison official who rejected Mr. Welch's grievance for not starting at the informal level. And then we have this conflicting testimony on behalf of NDOC as an organization as a whole, saying, no, actually, you can do that. So here we have two NDOC officials disagreeing on the very basics of how this system is supposed to work. And we think that that shows, under Ross, you know, an example of how a system can be so opaque that no one can really discern how it's supposed to work, even the officials that are supposed to be enforcing it.
Yeah, I think your, with respect, counsel, your bottom line strikes me as what Judge Smith said. I'm looking at sort of the end of the blue brief on page 29. During this period, he filed 189 grievances. That represents a 96% failure rate. These consistent failures of his attempts to grieve demonstrate the concern the Supreme Court noted in Ross that the grievance system too often operated as a simple dead end to Welch. And it sure looks to me like he's arguing that I don't have to exhaust administrative procedures because when I do, I typically lose.
That is one interpretation, and I would say that that is also supported by this court's precedent in Sapp v. Kimbrell, where this court held that if a grievance is repeatedly screened out for improper reasons, that an inmate might be left with a reasonable belief that the grievance system will not be available to
him. But the key word in that is improper. If you just file, it can't be the law that if you file an enormous volume of frivolous and meritless petitions, that then bootstraps you into saying, I no longer need to exhaust because it never works, I never win.
And no, Your Honor, that is not what we are arguing. And that percentage of success rate was just once amongst many arguments we made demonstrating that the system is opaque. Again, we also rely on the NDOC's designee's testimony, where several times they're at odds with what happened in Mr. Welch's own case. We have irreconcilable internal conflicts amongst the grievance policy itself. For example, another huge dead end in the grievance procedure is that it does not allow inmates to re-grieve issues if they've made a mistake. Not only is this clear from the face of the procedure itself, which is AR 740.034E, the NDOC designee testified that this provision effectively operates as a dead end two separate times. And I do see that I'm cutting into my rebuttal
time.
Yeah,
you can please save your time.
Okay. Thank you, Your Honors.
Very well. Mr. Davis.
I want to thank the court for the opportunity to present my issues and for the arguments of opposing counsel. First of all, the district court properly granted defendant's motion for summary judgment because Kendrell Welch failed to exhaust his administrative remedies, which are mandated by the PLRA and the Supreme Court's decision in Woodruff. Nevertheless, even if Welch had exhausted, defendants are entitled to qualified immunity because he points to no clearly established precedent under the facts of this case, which would cause the defendants to believe that they retaliated against Welch or failed to protect him. First, I'm going to address failure to exhaust, and then I'm going to proceed on to qualified immunity. Welch wrongly insists that the remedies in NDOC 740 were unavailable to him. This, however, is not a case, like I think your honors have suggested, it's not a case of unavailable remedies, but a case of available remedies that Welch just refused to utilize. Welch was well-versed in the grievance process. There's lots of facts in this case, but I think this is probably the most telling. In the 5 years before submitting his complaint, Welch successfully navigated the three steps of the grievance process in 30 occasions. Okay, so that's once every 2 months. I can hardly believe that Welch can say, I don't know how to do this, when he's done it 30 times in 5 years, once every 2 months.
When you say successfully, you mean he went through the whole process?
He went through the process.
He
got a successful result. And I want to talk a little bit about that successful result, this thing. They're kind of arguing a quota, that somehow the NDOC is required to have a quota about how many grievances we grant. I mean, I think the court's already said that that's kind of ridiculous, because what would that lead to? That would lead to, well, hey, this year we only granted 10% of the grievances in our case. The Ninth Circuit is then going to tell us, hey, our remedies aren't available. We got to up that. We got to grant 20% or 30% or whatever arbitrary number the court would decide.
It does seem to be an odd argument, but it does seem to be in part what your friend is arguing.
Right. And that's what I agree, Your Honor. Additionally, they don't dispute that the NDOC AR 740s were available in the law library, which bars any claim of unavailability. And I would cite the court to the Cortanas case and the Wilson case. Additionally, Wilson was repeatedly instructed about how to file grievances. Wilson does not deny he attended orientations, and even if Wilkes made a mistake, he was told how to correct the grievance and given an opportunity to resubmit. But guess what? Wilkes just didn't want to resubmit.
What's your response to opposing counsel's argument that under this system you can't regrieve if you make a mistake?
Well, that would be wrong, because that's exactly contrary to the record of this case, Your Honor. When he put the thing for tracking purposes only, which he pulled out of the rules, which the rules says three discrete ways that you can use that. And so Wilkes knew that he was only supposed to do that. He was just trying to make an argument to bypass it without following the plain language of the rule, but could you repeat the question, Your Honor?
She claimed that under this system, if you make a mistake, you can't regrieve it.
So, for example, in that particular instance, he was given an opportunity. He told, "Don't put it under tracking. Start over." And in fact, he did start over again. But in that particular instance, what he did was he filed more than one grievance in a week. And this court has said that that's a perfectly reasonable limitation to say that an inmate can only file one grievance a week.
There are some exceptions to that if it's a true emergency, right?
That's true. And in fact, there are ways, if you read the AR 740, there are ways to have this where that if it's an emergency, the person can hand the grievance immediately to an officer and then it has to be ruled on within 24 hours.
So you said that this provision here that has the for tracking purposes is paragraph 10. You said it applies only to the three categories that are there, but the three categories are preceded by the phrase "such as," which suggests that they're not exclusive.
Well,
what else is covered by this?
I think what it's such as the similar kind of rules. And again, I think that provides the discretion for them to do emergency grievances and for allowing the warden to take up any grievance he wants. And in fact, I think that's the system that's permitted, that the warden can do it. But then when it says when the NDOC expressly tells him and says, "Hey, this isn't one of those instances, please resubmit," he can resubmit. And there's no reason why he shouldn't be resubmitting when they tell him it's not that business. I think that the NDOC is entitled to be able to interpret its rules, and as long as they give him an opportunity to resubmit, it cannot be unavailable. And I think Your Honors have made the point that this is not about the standard that the Supreme Court says is unavailability. That is the only standard this court is permitted to apply. The Supreme Court has been very clear about that in Ross, that you can only apply unavailability. And what Your Honors have been saying is they're not arguing unavailability. They're arguing unsuccessful. That hey, if he files enough unsuccessful grievances, then guess what? He doesn't have to grieve anymore. Well, and we know that can't be the rule. Well, therefore, has failed to come back with any evidence showing that something in this particular case has made the three straightforward steps in NDRC effectively unavailable to him. Because that's not the case at all here. They were fully available to him. He just did not want to follow the process. I want to talk about a little bit about the deposition of the sergeant. First of all, that deposition had nothing to do with, and wasn't. These were just questions that came out of left field about the interpretation of the grievance procedures. And I would like to make clear that sergeants really don't have any involvement in the grievance process. They're not answering grievances. They're not talking about grievances. And so it's not surprising that they are unfamiliar with the grievance process in this case. The people who are responsible for responding to grievances are the supervisors, the deputy, the wardens, and the directors or deputy directors. And so that's not hardly surprising at all. Walt admits that under Ross, limits the time for grievances that are straightforward are a dead end, or unknowable, or where prison officials make thwart advantage to take the or affirmatively thwarting the presence the him from doing a grievance. And I submit that they haven't established any one of those things. And those are the only things that Ross has said that allowed to show unavailability. I want to talk briefly a moment about qualified immunity. Defendants are also entitled to qualified immunity because Welch has not and cannot point to any authority showing a violation of a clearly established right.
If we didn't agree, you're raising this as an alternative argument, but if we didn't agree on exhaustion, why wouldn't we just send this issue? Because the district court didn't reach this issue, did it?
They did not, Your Honor. But the thing is what qualified immunity is immunity from litigation. I mean, that's what's protected. It says we're immune from discovery, we're immune from all this. And so I think this court has an obligation to take up the issue so that because we're entitled to qualified immunity.
Yeah, but counsel, I mean, putting aside the important concern Judge Collins raised, I mean, when I look at the allegations here, the allegations are that he was referred to as a snitch in front of other inmates, that is maybe not the worst thing that you could be labeled with in a prison system, but it's pretty bad. And don't we have cases saying that if that is done in retaliation and exposes an inmate to a potential serious problem, that can state a constitutional claim? Why, based on the record that we have here, if we chose to reject the exhaustion argument, why wouldn't that get past the stage of this case that it was at?
Well, first of all, I don't think Your Honors are correct. Respectfully disagree with Your Honors that there are cases, published opinions in the Ninth Circuit or in other circuits, or a consensus of authority from other circuits saying that being a snitch is an adverse action. But that's not what happened here, Your Honors. He was never called a snitch. There's no evidence in the record, no admissible evidence in the record that he was called a snitch. What there is there's double hearsay. And what we all know that double hearsay is not admissible evidence, and you have to have admissible evidence to overcome summary judgment. What there is in other words, in order to overcome qualified immunity with respect to his retaliation claim, Welch would have to point to circuit precedent establishing that a correction officer remarking that an inmate had been riding kites on him, which I think other inmates would be glad that he's riding kites on a correction officer, was an adverse action after the inmate threatened to file a grievance, which the correction officer had no knowledge of. And that's the facts in this case. And, of course, there is no precedent because under the current established precedent, harsh words are not an adverse action under Mulligan.
Harsh words are different than labeling someone who reports things to prison staff, whether it is about another inmate, a gang member, or an ACO, that carries a label with it, which is a label you never want to have in prison. And there are documented cases of somebody who is stuck with that label suffering very adverse consequences.
Well, but Your Honor, there is no, again, I would point Your Honor, there is no admissible evidence that he was ever labeled a snitch. All that he said was, an inmate has been riding kites on him. And that's not even harsh word, Your Honor. That's the only admissible evidence in this case.
Okay. Other questions by my colleagues? All right. Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
So we have some rebuttal time.
Thank you, Your Honors. I'd like to start off with just what I think is a very important correction to how my opponent characterized the record. At that Rule 30b-6 deposition, the designee that defendants chose was the warden of another NDOC facility with over 25 years of correctional experience. And in that notice for that deposition, a grievance policy discussion was noticed as one of those topics. So I would really reject any implication that this came out of left field or that the defendants were not properly noticed about that subject of the 30b-6 deposition. I might also say we are absolutely saying that remedies were unavailable. We are not saying that Mr. Welch just failed to follow them. We are arguing that they are unavailable, both kind of writ large and also how it played out in Mr. Welch's specific case.
At bottom, though, as we've talked about, it seems, reading the pleadings and, frankly, listening to you today, What it really boils down to is that if your client or others don't win enough in their grievances, that's when you've got a legitimate case. It's pretty clear that he knew the system. My colleague has pointed out some ways in which he did that. Other than a quota or some concept of you got to allow them to win a certain number of cases, what are you pointing us to? What are you looking for from this court to clarify when what happened here it was enough or not enough?
So, Your Honor, we are not arguing for a quota argument. That is one small piece of what we're arguing. But really, like what I've been talking about today, we have different NDOC officials disagreeing on the very basics of how...
Is that the rule, then? If you have more than one NDOC official that disagrees, that's enough to show that it's opaque?
It may be, Your Honor, especially if it's something as basic as where an inmate is supposed to start, and if they're rejected, if they're at crosshairs about why, and when the AR itself doesn't say who's right. It's irreconcilable. I also wanted to point out what Your Honor was asking about the inability for an inmate to regrieve something if they made a mistake. And I'm just reading directly from 3 ER552, that subsection E. Grievances that have the same issue and a previously filed grievance will not be accepted, even if the requested action or remedy is different on the subsequent grievance. And when asked about that at the 30P6 deposition, the designee agreed several times that that does operate as a dead end. And in this case, Mr. Welch was not told to refile his grievance. It simply said, must start at the informal level, rejected. It did not give him a path forward, and on the face of the ARs, he did not have a path forward.
Okay. Other questions about my colleague? All right.
Thank you,
thanks to both counsel for your argument. The case just argued is submitted.